Stephen A. Smith is joining me now. Stephen, who are you trying to send a message to? Republicans, Democrats, African Americans, all of the above?
I'd go with all of the above. That sounds about right. But specifically the Democratic Party, from the standpoint that I definitely believe that the black vote has been taken for granted. And primarily the black community is at fault, in my estimation, in that regard, simply because on one hand, we're giving one party our vote because they've successfully gone about the business of convincing our community that the other party, the Republican Party, is completely against the interest of the black community. And as a result, we've been very transparent in our support. We've bought it hook, line, and sinker. We look at the Republican Party. I'm not talking about every single one of us, of course, but vast majority of black Americans look at the Republican Party as the enemy. We look at the Democratic Party, even tacitly, as our support base. And as a result, we are very transparent in our support for them. So because of it, they have a license to take us for granted. The Republican Party has a license to summarily dismiss us because they believe they'll never get our vote anyway. And then we end up finding ourselves devoid of any kind of representation whatsoever because nobody is really competing to garner our vote and our support. So I said what I said because I wanted folks in my community to stand up and recognize that if you go to a house or you go buy a car or whatever the case may be, you don't just see something you want and say, I want that. Tell me what the price is and I'll pay for it. Somebody has to flatter you in order to garner your dollars and your support. I think the same should apply to politicians who represent us.
Let me put this in the context of 2016, because I think given, sure, given the monolithic nature of the African-American vote, a lot of Republicans don't even make the ask. Rand Paul,
right,
is making the ask. Is there anything that he can say that you think can change this equation?
Well, first of all, he can highlight some of the inconsistencies and discrepancies the opposing party might be throwing in our direction, things that we may not know. That's number one. Number two, one of the things that you need to do as a Republican, particularly if you're running for the presidency, you have to surround yourself with a bunch of folks that look like us and not just you, that look like Hispanics and not just you.
Touch me in the pouring rain, and the moment that you wander far from me, I want to feel you in my arms again. And you come to me on a summer breeze, keep me warm in your love, then you softly leave, and it's me you need to share. How deep is your love?
That's Stephen A. Smith on CNN. And, well, not everybody loved it. Carl Jeffers is one of our most treasured guests. He's usually on Martin Luther King Day or some racial tension taking place across the country. He does a terrific job with that, whether he's writing for the Huffington Post, guesting on this show or the Imus in the Morning show. Always does a great job. And he did write yesterday or the day before in the Huffington Post, note to Stephen A. Smith, who now, you know, he's done with ESPN. He now works with my former co-worker and dear friend Christopher Mad Dog Russo on Mad Dog's Sirius XM channel, channel 86. Note to Stephen A. Smith, stick to sports, not politics. So with that said, here he is, my dear friend Carl Jeffers. Good morning, Carl. How are you, pal?
I'm good, Sid, but I have to tell you that I saw the original interview that Stephen A. Smith did with Michael Smirkanish, which prompted me to write the editorial I did in the Huffington Post that people can still find. And I have to tell you, Sid, that was my response then. I sat here these last few minutes listening to you replay that interview. Mm-hmm. I'm madder now than I was then, a week and a half ago when he said that. Where do we want to start, Sid? Devoid, it leaves us devoid of any representation. I'll tell you what's devoid of any representation. You got 46 members of the Congressional Black Caucus, with the exception of two in the last round, all black Democrats, representing some 85% of the population of the major cities and the African-American population in the country. You got an African-American person in the White House. Who elected him? Republicans? You know, I mean, where was devoid of representation? Now, a second, he says Rand Paul should tell us what the inconsistencies are with the Democrats. No, if we're ever going to consider a Republican, he's going to have to tell us not what we have problems with the Democrats. He's got to tell us what they're going to do differently than what they've done.
In all fairness, Rand Paul is a guy that's kind of breaking away, and he has gone into some of the urban communities and spent some time with African-American leaders across the country in an attempt, by the way, to do something a little more democratic than the GOP usually does. Let me ask you this right off the bat.
You'll appreciate this line, because it comes from the 1940s, yeah. But it'll sum up my reaction to that, the African-American community at that time was pretty much limited to the press of black newspapers, and they were talking about how things were changing, and they were saying that it's no longer possible to wrap up the black vote by taking an airplane ride with Joe Lewis.
That's what exactly you're telling me about.
Tell
me this, though. Give me, and I want this, Carl Jeppers, as you can do this, and there were two things. We have about 12 more minutes, but there are two things I want to touch on today, this and what's going on in Indianapolis, too, with the anti-gay stuff. Tell me what the great fear is, when a Republican takes over, because you're the person to say on this show that here's Barack Obama, Democrat and African American, and you don't think he's done a very good job in lots of spots.
In the area where he could have made the most incredibly significant impact long term for his legacy, which is changing the dynamic of the conversation about race in America. I think historians will look back on his administration and say he missed that opportunity. That's the area where I have the biggest challenge and disappointment in Obama, and it's a major area for me. It's a major concern. Sure. But in the other areas, I support him. And as you know, Sid, I supported him enthusiastically, but only after he won enough delegates to eliminate Hillary Clinton. I supported Hillary Clinton all the way to the point when she lost. And once she lost, I was absolutely enthusiastically supporting Obama. And the reason I was supporting her was because I felt that he was going to be too weak to win. And I'm telling you, Sid, and I take every opportunity to make this point whenever it comes up. If it had not been for the economic recession and the economic crisis that exploded the weekend of September 15th, 2008, which changed the dynamic of this election from being a referendum about Barack Obama, in which case he was going to lose, and turned it into a referendum on John McCain and his links to the Bush administration, in which case they were going to lose. If it had not been for that, Barack Obama would have lost, and I felt that without that, Hillary Clinton would have been the stronger candidate. That was why I was supporting her, because I didn't feel he was strong enough to win. And there's no one out there who can prove me wrong, because they don't know. At this point, none of us do, but they can absolutely prove me wrong about what would have happened in that election had not the economic crisis deferred. Because I'm telling you, Sid, you know what happened? A lot of working-class, blue-collar whites in the country, after that crisis of September 15th, you know what they said? You know what? I'm not comfortable with voting for an African-American for president. I'm not ready for him. But doggone it, if he's going to help me keep my job and keep my house a little bit longer before they turned in on my mortgage, then you know what? I'll vote for him for now. Well, let's give him 2 or 3 months, see what he does. That was the prevailing attitude.
Yeah, no, I agree with you. So you make the point in your very fine column, note to Stephen A. Smith, stick to sports, not politics, in the Huffington Post. We know this. You look at some of the Democratic presidents, John F. Kennedy Jr., Lyndon Johnson, even Jimmy Carter, who was a horrendous president, but in this case he worked well for Bill Clinton, Barack Obama, that there's no question African-American people did better when those guys were in the office. So what is the great fear if, in fact, the Republican takes over? What's the great fear?
Well, the great fear is having to live with what we've lived with in the past. Whenever Republicans are running for national office, and in many cases now it's even at the state level, they do actually solicit the minority vote. They certainly solicit the Hispanic vote, and they solicit the African-American vote. And by the way, the fact that Rand Paul and a couple of others will now, even George W. Bush did in his last year, go to the annual NAACP convention, that's wonderful. Why? Why? Because that helps the conversation. But it doesn't change the policy. The fear is, Sid, they will go out and they will campaign and they'll highlight these things that Stephen A. Smith wants them to highlight. Then they get elected. And what do? The first day in office, they pull all the computers out of the schools. The second day, they cut the school lunches. The third day, they eliminate all of the boards and commissions on civil rights. And then who's left with no computers and no school lunches? The African-American kids in the urban areas. Why? Because all of the white kids are out in the suburbs where their families have a higher tax base that they can replace what they lose. Who comes in and immediately wants to put a RoboCop every 100 feet at the border in order to try to lock out the immigration status situation for so many immigrants and then say, let's deal with the border first and then we'll deal with immigration reform? Hispanics aren't buying that either. The fact is, we know how that works. Once they get the border the way they want it, they're not going to deal with anything. That's the oldest trick in the book. Give me what I need today, and then we can come back and we'll revisit your issues next week. Who's buying that anymore? No, Stephen A. Smith is completely off base with that particular assertion because they always do it. Now, I will say this for Republicans, Steve, because I have said this all along. I have said that one day there's going to be a Republican national candidate running for office on the national ticket who will campaign for the African-American vote. He will not get the African-American vote. He will win the election, but he will govern as if he had gotten the African-American vote. When they do that, the next election, they will get a sizable percentage of the African-American vote. The problem is they never do that. They never govern that way. And secondly, even if they wanted to, the Republican Party is so structured that the base of the Republican Party would never allow a moderate or progressive national leader to move to the progressive things. They would never stand for someone saying, wait a minute, let's not cut taxes for the rich. Let's not increase defense spending unless we find a way to keep those computers in the schools and to keep the school lunches there for these kids. That's what they would need, and they're not getting that, and they won't get that. But I have said if they could somehow put that kind of a scenario together, they would have a chance.
Sure. Stephen A. Smith does this god-awful show. It's very popular, don't get me wrong, but it's awful with this guy, Skip Bayless.
Are you talking about Skip Bayless, First Take? Listen, I'll acknowledge, by the way, the show was tanking. Ratings were completely plunging.
They've done well. He's done a good
job. And then when Stephen A. Smith joined the show, the ratings went up. I love him on sports. And when it comes to basketball, I look on the left on the columns on ESPN to see when they have a segment with Stephen A. Smith. I'm just saying that when he comes to this, unless you can speak with more evidential information about the facts, don't confuse the issue for African Americans and don't insult us, Stephen.
You should be on that show. They should take Skip Bayless off one day. And if he, wants to jump into the political fray like I've done, call this would be you and Stephen A. on First Take would be great.
Well, Steve, you know what, Sid? From your lips to God's ears. But, but you know what? Let's expand this just a little bit because this is important. A couple of the people who responded that were defending Stephen A. and you could tell they were. By the way, do you want to know what the Republicans are doing? I'm not even talking about the past now. Let's look at the future. From 2016, what have they done? The first major candidate to send us a new signal, he sent a new signal. He goes to Liberty University, the home of Jerry Falwell, where he then proclaims his fundamentalist evangelical principles upon which the Republican Party seems to be based. He couldn't have done any worse if after that he had flown over to the Citadel and put on a uniform.
Listen, we know Ted Cruz is crazy. Don't worry about him.
Ted Cruz is the kind of candidate that a Jeb Bush will have to somehow eradicate from the political scene in order to get the nomination. Yeah. And that will move Bush and others so far to the right that when you get to the main general primary, the general election, they would have to come too far back to get to the center. The same thing happens all over again. But you know, people said, well, what about not only Stephen A. Smith is saying this, but Charles Barkley said that what have we gotten from for voting for liberals and Democrats for the last 50 years. Absolutely nothing. And that's more outrageous even than Stephen A. Smith. Let me tell you something, Sid, and your viewers and listeners right now will appreciate this little history. Charles Barkley went to Auburn University. Auburn University is in Alabama. I'll tell you one thing we got, Mr. Barkley, over the last 50 years as a result of voting for Democrats. We got you an education, because without the Democrats, you wouldn't have never gotten into the University of Alabama. Do you realize, I'm not talking about the 1930s, the 1940s. In the 1960s, a Democratic president, John F. Kennedy, gave the authorization to his brother, another Democrat who was the Attorney General of the United States, who then authorized his Deputy Attorney General, Nicholas Katzenbach, God rest his soul, who was Jewish and understood the pain of intolerance and lack of diversity and understanding. And Nicholas Katzenbach, Mr. Barkley, went down to the steps of the University of Alabama, faced off against George Wallace, the governor, and said, "Sir, will you turn away and allow us to enroll these students in the University of Alabama?" And he had deputized the National Guard, ready to enforce that. And it's because of that, that Charles Barkley later, several years later, was able to go to the University of Auburn. Where were the Republicans standing around helping and supporting that?
No doubt. I can't argue any of that. That is 100%
true. And here's another one.
Yep.
In the early 60s, in the 61, 62, the Rat Pack first went to Las Vegas. Frank Sinatra, Dean Martin, Joey Bishop, and, of course, our friend Sammy Davis Jr. Except one little difference. Sammy Davis couldn't stay at the hotels where they were performing. And when Frank Sinatra found out about it, he told the hotels, "If Sammy can't have a room here, then we're going to pack up the show and leave." And he cleared it with the Banana Family. They like Sammy, so everything was cool.
Yeah.
And I'm telling you that Charles Barkley, we know his reputation. He's made millions, and he spent a lot of time in Vegas gambling that money away. Mr. Barkley, thanks to the Democrats, because Lyndon Johnson signed the open housing law, the Public Accommodations Bill, and the Civil Rights Act, and the Voting Rights Act.
You're right about all this, but we're going to slow down about JFK Jr. I saw a wonderful piece yesterday on the CBS Early Show. Did you see this?
I did not see that.
All right, Sunday Morning with Charles Osgood. You can't beat it. Frank Sinatra.
I love Charles Osgood. He's
great.
He's terrific.
Frank
yes, he
Sinatra
is.
Would have been 100 years old this year.
Uh-huh.
And they did a wonderful interview with his daughter, who said that one of the true frustrations in Frank Sinatra's life was that Sammy Davis Jr., of course, part of that Rat Pack,
was
one of his best friends, and
that's
he loved Sammy, and he traveled with Sammy.
That's right.
But the other problem was he was very, very close with John F. Kennedy Jr., Mr. Democrat President, paved the way for Lyndon Johnson, and it was John F. Kennedy Jr. who said to Frank Sinatra, "He can't come around. He can't come to inaugurals. He can't come to the..." It was John F. Kennedy Jr. who was telling Frank, and Frank had to listen against his will because it was still the president and it was a Kennedy. So I'm just telling you.
Well, actually, now let's be fair to Kennedy, because the reality is that it was Joseph Kennedy who had told Peter Lawford and
Dean Martin,
Frank Sinatra, that
they
could not associate and fraternize with blacks in the public way that they were doing.
Right.
I mean, he even chased Peter Lawford away from the country club because Lawford was down at the parking lot fraternizing with the black car attendants. I mean, so Joseph Kennedy's influence, and Joseph Kennedy was a very anti-Semite. He was racist.
He's a bad
guy. But here's what he did, though. He raised his children, Sid, to understand that public service, when you have the kind of money that we have, the family name that we have, he raised them to understand that public service requires that you give back and that you be concerned about those who are in the lower tiers of society. That was the difference between even someone as vile as Joseph Kennedy and the Republicans living up on the North Shore in the big mansions who were still longing for the days of Herbert Hoover. That's the difference.
That's a big difference. All right, so listen, on the way out here, and again, today you're just on fire. You're always great. Talking about Barkley, you're right about that. He sounded very, very, he sounded stupid, to be honest. But in his defense, he's been very outspoken about the Final Four being moved from Indianapolis, where Governor Pence in Indiana has once again allowed this law to go through where businesses can actually discriminate against gays. So on one hand, yes, Barkley did sound silly there, but you got to give him a round of applause for being outspoken about what's going on in Indiana, yes?
Well, I don't have to give him an applause level for that, but I think that, first of all, I think all of us, we would all be better off in the country if we didn't lock everybody in to a position that then, based on that, you make assumptions about what their position is going to be on every issue. There are issues where I come on, and I'm on your show, and I've taken positions that are, in fact, not the liberal position,
yes,
or not the,
yes,
black position, like Ferguson, right, and other things, because they're my position on that issue. And we should stop assuming that because someone has a position on this issue, that their position, therefore, is predictable on all of the other issues. That's one of the biggest problems we have starting right off. So when I address Charles Barkley on the Indiana situation, I don't have to then say, well, this mitigates what you said about race. First of all, nothing could mitigate what someone in his position is saying about race when it's so far off. But I can applaud him. I can agree with him on this. And then we'll see how his position is on the next issue that comes up, and I address it one at a time. Now, the governor, Mike Pence, another conservative Republican, by the way, who had thoughts of running for president, I think maybe would like to get the VP nomination. He can throw that one away for now. But yeah. Governor Pence, you know what he said this weekend? He says, I would have never voted or signed the bill if it was going to turn out to be a discrimination bill. Oh, really? Oh, is that the way it works now? In other words, what governor or what president would ever come out and say, I'm signing this bill because it discriminates against this group?
Right. And although, by the way, two things. First of all, I said John F. Kennedy Jr., but there's no Jr., of course. His father was Joseph.
No, it's right. That's right. That's why I said Joseph.
Right. By the way, Barack Obama was for this bill. And just so you know, Hillary Clinton has come out, and she's yelling and screaming like Charles Barkley, but it was her husband who introduced this thing. Am I right there? Yes.
Yes, you are right there. You are right there, which is one reason why I'm glad I made the statement that you can't lock people in on one issue because of how they treat another issue. And Bill Clinton, without question, has been and has done as much for African Americans as any the Democratic presidents who have done the most. But that doesn't mean that he was perfect on all scores or on all counts, but it does mean that we have a pattern there, that we have a track record. And what Stephen A. Smith is lacking is the understanding that you can't replace an actual track record with a prediction of what you would like to do if you were given a chance with that vote. And that was why in my article I said, we cannot take that chance. And that's why we have to stay where we have the power. And one of the most important points I made, too, Sid, was that in terms of this phrase, because I hate this phrase, the Democrats keep taking us for granted. It's like somebody fed you that line, and you just throw it out there because you think it sounds good, makes you look like you're fair and impartial. The reality is the African-American community, as a voting bloc, as a power bloc, has now become so entrenched in the Democratic Party as a power base with the deputy whips and all of the positions they have, and with the 85% of the African-American vote represented by black Democrats, that even if the Democratic Party wanted to take the black vote for granted, they couldn't because blacks have too much power in the party to allow that to happen. So Stephen A. Smith is completely wrong there as well.
Fantastic. I'm glad you brought all this up. I'm glad you wrote this column, and I'm glad that you you exposed the truth. You're the best. I love you, and we'll do something again very soon. I know you spoke to Steve yesterday. It's going to get done, so I love you. We'll talk
all
to you
right.
again very soon.
We'll
excellent
look forward
job.
To that.
Thank you, Carl. Excellent job. Carl Jeffers, and I really urge and compel all of you to go read his story, Note to Stephen A. Smith, Stick to Sports, Not Politics, in the Huffington Post. Excellent job, really opining on both issues today. Stephen A. Smith's little speech there on CNN, and of course, what's going on in Indiana. Well, we're getting ready for Final Four action this weekend before Monday night, a week from tonight, the final championship game, Michigan State taking on Duke, and Kentucky will take on Wisconsin. In on Duke and Kentucky will take on Wisconsin. In on Duke and Kentucky will take on Wisconsin. In on Duke.